4.18. This number is the reason that you're alive right now. Under normal conditions, that's how many joules of energy you need to raise the temperature of a gram of water by 1 degree Celsius. Also known as the specific heat capacity of water, this value, this property of water, it's special. You see, if this value were any different, life as we know it would not exist. If it were higher, more energy would be needed to raise the temperature of water. The amount of water that evaporates into the atmosphere would reduce, and that means so would rainfall. This also means that there would be a greater difference between the temperature of air near land and the air near water. The resulting changes in pressure would lead to changes in the wind speed, temperatures would significantly drop, and species would slowly go extinct. On the other hand, if the heat capacity were lower than it is now, water would evaporate much quicker, and it would no longer be able to regulate the temperature of the Earth as it does now. It would rain all the time, crops would die, and again, species would slowly go extinct. 4.18, it seems, is just the right amount of energy. This just rightness is seen in other aspects of life on Earth too, including where it sits in the solar system. Too close to the sun, and the water would just boil away before it could form. Too far, and it would just freeze. But all these properties are in some way, shape, or form related to water, and so it's no wonder then that the search for life anywhere in space is essentially a search for water. And we found it. Lots of it, actually. You see, hydrogen is the most abundant element in the universe, and oxygen is the third most abundant. In between them is helium, which doesn't really react with much. So when the conditions are appropriate, water can be formed. And it is. Given the scale of it all and how old the universe is, you'd imagine that there must be some planets in an Earth-like distance from their respective stars to allow for the formation of liquid water, and by extension, life. Dr. Frank Drake attempted to answer this very question in 1961, using the Drake equation. He used factors like the average rate of star formation, how many of those stars could have planets, how many of those planets might develop intelligent life forms that could possibly communicate, and so on. Instead of the entire universe, Drake focused only on our galaxy, which is huge, and for practical limitations of speed and time, really the only thing we should worry about anyway. Understandably, these inputs are all assumptions, and as such, the output of this equation is also an assumption. Depending on who and when you ask, the result of the Drake equation could be anything from a small number that is barely greater than zero to a number in the tens of millions. Our intuition tells us that if that number were somewhere in between that immense range, the Milky Way should be beaming with advanced civilizations making interplanetary journeys with regularity. Just our galaxy, one of the trillions out there, is so incredibly large that even with astronomically low odds, you would expect to find at least some other civilizations. To give you a sense of how large it is, modern humans have been around for nearly 200,000 years, and in that time, light, at its incredible speed, has traveled the complete width of the Milky Way. Only twice. Okay, so let's run through this. The Milky Way has a lot of stars, and a lot of those stars have a lot of planets, and a lot of those planets should have a lot of water, and a lot of those planets have been around a lot longer than Earth, so therefore they should have a head start compared to Earth. So that must mean that there are civilizations a lot more advanced than ours, which should have all the tools they need to communicate with us. If that's the case, there's just one problem. Where is everybody? That's the question Enrico Fermi asked in 1950. Using a similar line of reasoning that I just talked about, Fermi too was confused as to why we hadn't already come in contact with aliens, considering how abundant they should have been. Known more popularly as the Fermi paradox, this question draws attention to the discrepancy between the supposed high likelihood of civilizations out there and the lack of observational evidence to prove their existence. To this day, 70 years after Fermi's equation, even with the scientific advancements that we've made, we are yet to receive any signals from a civilization other than our own. So really, where is everybody? Nearly 50 years after Fermi asked his famous question, an economist named Robin Hanson figured that, just as humanity had done in the past, we may have just been asking the wrong question all along. He felt that, instead of sticking to the assumption that the universe should be filled with life forms like our own, we should accept what the evidence is telling us, that life is exceedingly rare, and that the Earth is the only planet we know that has it, and that we should use that information to understand why we're here and how long we might have. Well, if that's the case, Hanson argued, then there must be something wrong with the typical steps of reasoning that lead to the incorrect perception of life's abundance. Either one or more of these steps are wrong, or one or more of these steps are so incredibly improbable, life elsewhere is practically impossible. And thus, the idea of the Great Filter was born, a hindrance that is so immense in its complexity and improbability that we are quite literally the only species to ever get past it. It's perfectly possible that the Great Filter was whatever initiated abiogenesis, the creation of life from non-living, simple organic compounds. After all, it's a process that runs counter to the laws of thermodynamics, in that it involves molecules to spontaneously arrange themselves in an ordered, life-giving manner. It would be like a cold cup of water just naturally going hot, which, by the way, is physically possible, only unimaginably unlikely. Things like that just don't happen. Hot things go cold and things tend towards disorder, so life never really should have formed. The Great Filter could also be the formation of complex celled organisms. Or, it could be the first proper replication of DNA that allowed for just enough mutation that would eventually sow the seeds for evolution. Or, it could be the collision of Earth with a protoplanet named Theia that led to the creation of the moon, and with it a reliable axis and a stable climate for life to flourish in. It could be a lot of things, really. I don't know. Regardless, if we were to assume that the Great Filter was indeed in our past, it would explain why we are the only ones remaining and why the rest of the universe seems so utterly dead. But it would also say that we have done it. We've made it past the Great Filter, everyone gets a pat on the back, and that's really it. But what if the Great Filter is ahead of us? What if the universe was, indeed, beaming with life just as we expected it to? But something simply kept filtering or killing civilizations one after another, which is why no one has really reached out to us. And more importantly, what if we're next? Given the general lack of evidence regarding other planets and why they don't have life, a filter in the future could be just as likely as one in the past, if not more likely. So, what are some of the possible filters that could possibly wipe out life as we know it? As it turns out, the abundance of galaxies that we point to when we search for other forms of life may just be the very reason why they don't exist. Our neighboring galaxy, Andromeda, is a mere 2.5 million light years away from us, but scientists predict that it's getting closer, in about 4 billion years, it might collide with the Milky Way. These collisions are common enough in the cosmic timescales that they're important, and although the likelihood of planets colliding with each other is exceedingly rare given the distances between stars and planets, other massive objects might interfere with the effect of gravity of Earth, or whatever planet humanity is on when Andromeda and the Milky Way galaxy collide. This might plug them out of the orbit they were in, and jettison them out into the emptiness of space, where life simply ceases to exist. Extrapolate this possibility far enough, and you have a possible explanation as to why life is so rare. The cosmic commonality of galactic collisions keeps destroying life before it can take an intergalactic form. We've just been lucky so far. But you might think that galactic collisions are super rare and still in the distance, so how about we focus on something more closer to home, something more recent instead? In 1989, millions of people in Quebec woke up to heaters that were no longer working, and a city that was completely out of power. In one of the rare and extreme cases of coronal mass ejections, or simply solar storms, Quebec's entire power grid failed after 90-some seconds of this geomagnetic storm from the sun. Effects were felt in other parts of North America and beyond as radio signals were jammed, satellite measurements went haywire, and elevators stalled. Each of these solar storms can carry well over 100,000 times the energy of today's nuclear arsenal, so they're not to be taken lightly. But typically, these storms are distributed over the entire volume of space around the sun, so by the time it reaches Earth, most of it simply dies out. The Quebec-style outage is certainly rare. Scientists only predict such storms once every 100 years. But one only needs to think of a world where we rely on electricity more than we do now, where not just our phones, but our cars, planes, and even the military run on electricity. This is why these solar storms are classified as high-impact, low-frequency risks. They don't happen often, but when they do, they can be catastrophic. On the 15th of February, 2013, a dash cam in a car captured what is perhaps one of the most iconic space-related videos of recent times. Known as the Chelyabinsk meteor, it had entered into the Earth's atmosphere undetected, and due to its high velocity and shallow angle, had turned into a bright, brilliant streak of light that was at one point brighter than the sun. Before atmospheric entry, this 20-meter-wide object was believed to have had the energy of a bomb that is roughly 30 times more powerful than the one detonated in Hiroshima. It injured nearly 1,500 people and damaged over 7,000 buildings from shockwaves of the initial explosion. New evidence keeps emerging about the extinction-level threat that asteroids possess. You would think that with such a strong presence in pop culture and wisdom from the leading scientists of the world, the modern world would be much more aware of a threat than ever before, but we're actually pretty underprepared for such an event. Initial plans included nuking the asteroid, but that would in turn lead to smaller radiation-bathed chunks falling back onto Earth. Genius idea there, boys. Another strategy could be to fly a ship to the asteroid to create enough of an impact to shift its trajectory. But a 2019 paper from Johns Hopkins University suggested that asteroids are stronger and harder to destroy than previously thought. And given a large enough asteroid, none of these measures may be enough to save life as we know it. I chose these events specifically because they're all things that have already happened, albeit at a smaller scale, and continue to happen at a regular basis, galactically speaking. And while extinction-level events are rare, and very unlikely in the generations to come, We must remember that if life can sprout from improbabilities, it can end with them too. These are just some of the ways civilization can meet its end. Everything from social media, to a global pandemic, to civilization itself could be hypothesized as the great filter that awaits us as humanity's final test. But as always, there are some fundamental flaws with the idea of a great filter and the definitions of life it relies upon. Our sample size is one. This one data point is all we have ever known. How can we say with such confidence that a life form, advanced or otherwise, would even bother to explore beyond the comforts of its own home? Just because we exhibit colonial tendencies does not necessarily mean it has to be a universal phenomenon. And what if life just is different elsewhere? What if, instead of water, life lives off ammonia or methane or another such solvent, and the life that develops in it is fundamentally different from our own? Our current definitions of life are simply too specific to be able to incorporate all the possibilities hidden in the vastness of space. The idea of the great filter is shrouded in such deep improbabilities, and such extreme extrapolations that it is sometimes hard to pay attention. It is one of the more hypothetical topics out there, with so much simply based on speculation. There might as well be no great filter after all. The improbability of our existence may not be because of one or two steps in the line of reasoning, but because the entire process is one life nourishing coincidence after another. The great filter seeks to remind us about how lucky we are. Lucky to be here, at this very moment, out of the billions of years for which the universe has existed. Lucky to have come this far and be so aware of our place in reality. And lucky to realize how fine-tuned the universe seems to be for you and me to live in it. From the position of our galaxy to the exact values of the natural constants, one after another. From water's abundance to its specific heat capacity. 4.18. The great filter keeps me up at night. It's that constant not knowing that just gets under my skin. Not knowing something can be pretty frustrating, especially when you're expected to perform. But when it comes to learning, Brilliant has you covered. Brilliant is the best place to go to learn about everything math, science, and computer science related. It's extremely interactive, with each course either having code to write, puzzles to solve, or some other challenge to overcome. They're constantly adding new courses and finding new ways to challenge your brain. Whether you're in school or just someone who wants to learn more, Brilliant is where you need to be. They show you what you're learning and provide visual examples to solidify your understanding. I find this a lot easier than learning through actual books or videos on YouTube, as each course is tailored to making things simple to understand. With over 60 courses and new ones being added constantly, you're guaranteed to learn something new. If this sounds fun, head to brilliant.org/aperture for a free trial. The first 200 of you to check it out will get 20% off a premium subscription and will allow you to take every single course that Brilliant has to offer. You'll be supporting my channel and your future at the same time.